you to come preach, and then you get ready to go preach, and the Holy Spirit says, no. Well, he thinks that's the devil, because that can't be God, because I'm a preacher, and I'm having an opportunity to preach, and so I'm going to go preach. So he continues to pack and get himself ready, and again, the Holy Spirit says to him, I forbid you to go. Well, now he sees this is serious. And then he obeys, and he backs off. And when a door closes, and remember, some of you are just a few doors closing from your destiny. And when a door closes, and you already know you put the key in, and it's not working, and that door's closing, let me tell you what you got to learn to do. You got to learn to get your fingers back. You got to learn how to put your feet back, and mostly your feelings back, and not take it personal, because God's setting up something better for you. And you can't make fail yours. That works better on a tweet than in a pulpit, but anyway. Because no feels like a rejection. No feels like you're not good enough. No says you're not accepted. But a no may be the best thing you could ever hear. And you're going to have, and so when Paul finally gets the message, you're not going there, this is a no. Immediately when he turns his back on that door, the Bible says immediately a door opens and he goes into Macedonia. Now, from a biblical theological standpoint, this is a crucial door, because had Paul gone into that door, that was the door to the Jewish church, which the church at that point was all Jewish. And he was just going to go in there, and he was going to fuel the fire of the church touching the Jewish community. God shutting that door is what got us here today. Because the shut door forced him to look the other way, which was the door to the Gentiles, which the Bible says in Galatians that when he was in his mother's womb, God separated him and said, you will be the one that will take my gospel to the Gentile world. And thank God he didn't take the shut door as a rejection. Thank God he didn't get depressed and quit coming to church. Thank God. And when he turned, the door opened. Now, there's another little door that comes up. Let me go through this real quick. The door was a woman that started following Paul, and she started saying things to him that sounded good. They were actually great words, like, you are a mighty man of God. You, everybody, this guy, he is a mighty man of God. And that was going on for 2 or 3 days, but it didn't go right in Paul's spirit. He was like, have you ever been around somebody that says the right thing? It's like they know the words to the song, but the melody ain't right. It's like, yeah, something not there. Yeah. That's why we have wives, husband. Because you looked at me like nothing. Yeah. Them women, they know how to. You know, back in the old days on television, I remember having a television where you had a coat hanger and an aluminum ball. How many remember those days? Trying to get a signal, right? And yeah. No, yeah, that was before then. And women are like, they have a satellite dish. We get 3 channels, sex and food and sports and sleep, 4. Women have 500 channels. They pick up, they have a channel for mad, for angry, for upset. And you need that discernment, that ability to. And so Paul is listening to this woman, and the Bible says he's starting to get annoyed, and he lets it linger on, and he gets this sense in his spirit, and finally he realizes right words sounds right, but it isn't right. Because he understood the key that I'm about to put in your hands, he knew there are some relationships in your life that you may want them, that maybe somehow it doesn't feel right, but there are some relationships that you need to be aware of that are hindering you from stepping into your destiny. I'm not talking about your wife. I'm not talking about your husband. I'm not talking about your kids, although you would like that. But I'm going to tell you this, you know, these grandchildren, I have 3 grandchildren. I'm convinced grandchildren are God's reward for you not killing your kids. So just hang in there with it, because the reward's coming. But here's my word to you. There are some people in your life that it's time to go separate ways. Your destiny is too important. And then the last story is one everybody knows about, and that is, and that will lead me right up to the key. And that is, so Paul wants to go somewhere, and God says, no, shuts the door. Paul's got a relationship that's around him that's not right, and God says, walk away from it. Another door comes up quickly. He goes in. It changes the world. Then he's locked up and put in prison. And now the doors are shut in him. And now it's like, wow, God has locked us up. And this is a door that appears to be a closed door, but God says, no, we're opening up this one. And you remember it because it was the original Jailhouse Rock, remember? They worshiped and the doors came open. Which leads me to, we're moving quickly, you're doing fantastic, by the way, you're listening great. Which leads me to the key, because that's what you want, don't you? You want to have the key. I promised you a key, right? This key that you're about to get today is a revelation of what is called in Revelation 3, 7, and 8, the key of David. Now there's your clue. The key of David. What's the significance of this key? And how can this key be in my key? Right? How can this key change my world? The key of David. Well, David is the key. Now let's get a little theological lesson here in the next 90 seconds, all right? David was a man that God called twice, once in Samuel and once in Acts, as a man after God's own heart. Now, it wasn't that he was good looking. It wasn't that he was an incredible leader. It wasn't that he was perfect. Made a lot of mistakes. In fact, his brothers didn't even think he had the quality to be a leader. They gave him the bottom of the bottom job to be taken care of in their family as a shepherd. Did not see his potential. David had something that God said, he's a man after my own heart. And in fact, the key that will open and close doors for you, I'm going to name it after David. Because David gets me. Now, I don't have the time to develop how he got it, but David was the architect of worship. David, half the Psalms are written by David. David found and got access to God. He understood what God wanted. He understood how to communicate to God. You see, worship is God's language. When we all get to heaven, we'll all be speaking the same language. Not English, not Chinese, but worship. Worship is the oxygen that causes heaven and to function. Worship is the only gap between heaven and earth. If you know how to worship, you will step into God's presence, out of God's presence, simply by knowing how to use that key. I don't know how. I don't know if he was out there in the shepherd's field and he saw the trees moving and it looked like the hands. The leaves looked like hands and they were kind of clapping. And David said, I will clap the hands. But he started thinking about clapping before. He was a worshiper before Hillsong. Before Andre Crouch, he was a worshiper. And I don't know when he watched the ocean and it was waving and he thought, well, I can do that. And he started dancing. But David created the concept, cupping hands. I will shout with the voice of triumph. I will sing unto the Lord. And let me tell you something. David knew how to get God involved in his world. Here's the real kicker. David had learned how to get access to God's presence when it was illegal. You want me to explain that? Yeah. David found the key to opening up heaven and getting access to God's presence when it was illegal. Now, what I mean by that is that, you see, God's presence is so holy, it's so pure, it's so potent, that when God's presence came among the children of Israel, it had to be protected because out of ignorance and unawareness of how powerful he is, so his presence, his Shekinah presence, his presence is everywhere, but his Shekinah presence means concentrated presence, or manifest presence. So that Shekinah presence of God was put in a box. And that box was to cover it from anybody touching it or being exposed to it of whom was not properly postured for it. Because it's pure, it's potent, it's powerful. And then in that box, actually there's another word for it in the Bible. In the Hebrew it means box, but you might see it as the ark. And so the presence of God was in that box or the ark. And then it was put in a small tent. of which thick veils to keep it protected so that it could properly project when it was supposed to. That was the presence of God. And then outside there was another tent, and there was some protocol that you had to go through. And then outside of that was a bigger area of which there were sacrifices, and there was a place to cleanse your hands. And then outside that gate were people looking in wondering, "Whoa, I wonder what's going on in there." Now watch this. Am I boring you? Are you with me so far? All right, so watch this. And so once a year, one man would, they'd roll the dice, and somebody got picked to be the one that would enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise and then go in to the holies of holies, where they would feel the press essence of an almighty God. This was so pure. This was, in fact, they had to do everything just right. If they didn't just wash the hands right, if they didn't handle the sacrifice right, it was so important to do everything right. In fact, history says they would tie a rope around the priest, because if they didn't do it right, they were dead. And then nobody could even go in there and get him. It was so holy. They'd have to pull him out by the rope that they tied to his ankle. The Bible says the priest had bells along the bottom of their robe. They were the first to wear bell bottoms. Yeah, nah, that was bad. I know, that was bad. But the idea was, you're outside the tent. The other priests are inside the court. And they're going once a year into the holies of holies. And those bells are going, ding-a-ling, ding-a-ling, ding-a-ling. And they're marking that rope if I was there. Okay, he's now got right past the laver of water. Okay, all right, he's moving. Oh, he's now in the holy place. And now they know if he goes 3 more feet, he's going to pull himself. The tension of that rope is measure that he's in the holies of holies. And they wait. And now everything, the hands, the blood, the priest, he now takes his elbow. He's about to move the veil out. He's about to step into the holies of holies, where God is in a box. And as he steps in there, they're listening. Ding-a-ling. 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 Dang it. That's where Jingle Bell started, right there. I'm just trying to keep your attention. Some of you are trying to think about your dinner here. Here's my point. Here's my point. He gets in the presence of God. That priest is in the presence of God. See, the presence of God contains God. In his presence is fullness. Whenever you have a witness of God's presence, you just have a witness that you now have access to everything God is. You must learn to feel after the Lord. You must understand the value of that key. And see, David, while that was going on, here's the law. One man, once a year, can get in the presence of God. But David, out in the shepherd's field, found a key. And God said, even though it's illegal, this man has found access. Come up here, David, because you know how to worship. You found the key. Let me show you things that are about that. Let me give you a key that will shut doors. That's why when he was in the shepherd field and all the politics was going on, oh, I want to be the next king. I want to be the next king. And they never even gave David a chance. Not even a fair chance. He's way out in the shepherd's field. And everybody's there. All they're pushing and doing their politics and playing to get the next door open for them. David doesn't have to worry, because David's got the key. You're leaving here with the key. If I can show you that if you'll spend 7 to 8 minutes a day worshiping God. If I can convince you that you finish this year out by marking your daily routine with 7 to 8 minutes, turn on some music, find some soundtrack that will settle your heart and your spirit, and learn how to worship God for 7 to 8 minutes, and you worship until you can feel the press of His essence, because for a while you'll do it and you're not connecting. Some of you may stumble in your ability to worship. It's called worship in the Spirit. And because we are flesh, body, and we are soul, mind, will, and emotion, we have numbed our spirit. We don't know how to recognize our spirit. Certainly some of us not from our soul. As a result, our soul, our spirit is undeveloped. But you have a spirit. And when you learn how to recognize it, the Word will help you divide soul and spirit. And once you understand you have a spirit, then you understand that that's what you use to worship. Because animals can praise God. Creation can praise God. Jesus said, if you don't, the rocks will. But creation cannot worship because it requires a spirit. For they that worship must worship in spirit. And some of you have ignored your spirit. Some of you go all day long, and that spirit just needs 7 or 8 minutes to release itself in worship, and the heavens will open, and that key in your hand that you can sense, I worship until I feel the presence. And sometimes, some of you, you're going to go through it, and it's not going to happen quickly for some of you. You know, it's like those sensors at in bathrooms. I mean, they frustrate the daylights out of me. I travel a lot, and a lot of times you go in these airports, and I'm thankful, but you go in there, and it's all sensor. You go in there, in the water, and you're like. It's like nothing. And then when you finally get it, then your hands are all wet, and then you walk over to get a paper towel, and it's the same thing. Sometimes worship feels that way. You see people worshiping, they're raising their hand, and you're raising your hand, and they're saying, oh, I feel Jesus in this place. And you're like, I feel nothing. And sometimes it's a bit frustrating, because your physical body says, I ain't feeling it in my 5 senses. Let's move along. And you just say to your body, I've let you tell me everything to do all week long. You just be quiet right now. Then your soul steps in and says, man, you tell your soul, hey, my thoughts, my will, my emotions, you just hold on here because there's another part of me. That's the real me. This is the real me. This is the one that I need 7 or 8 minutes a day to lead me, to speak to me, to take me up and show me of things that are about to come. This is that when I worship, I walk away from my time of worship knowing that I have the key of David. And all through the day, and sometimes doors come open and close quickly. And I know I'm all right because I've already done my worship. I feel the key in my hand. I felt the press of God this morning when I got out of here. And Doug said, what are you going to preach today? I said, I'm not sure. He said, well, don't you? I said, it's all right because I've got the key. And I know when I know how to open the door. Are you hearing me? You may stumble in your ability to worship, but please, just like you stumbled in learning how to walk, treat this equally as important. Because if you can ever figure out how to hold God's attention and know how to communicate and touch God with your spirit, come up here and let me show you things that are about to happen. Now, let me tell you a story real quick, a couple stories, and then I'm going to release a prophetic word to you. Get ready. You're moments away from the thing dropping in your spirit. You're never going to forget this. It's going to change your life. See, life works destiny. I told you Oral Roberts would tell me all the time, Phil, destiny's looking towards miracles are coming at you every day. And every day you've got to have time, those 7 or 8 minutes where you're just like, stop, 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 worship, 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 because things are going to come at me today. And I have a philosophy called this. Treat everyone like they're the gatekeeper to your destiny. And one day you'll be right. Because I know that God works through relationships. And so every day I'm making sure that I got the right people in my life. And every day I'm looking for my, you know, the Bible says, give us this day our daily bread, right? And the bread is a picture of manna from the Old Testament. Every day God gave them manna. Now get your Bible out and get a concordance and look under the Greek, the Hebrew word for manna. The Hebrew word for manna means, what is it? And I like to call it this. Every day there's a what is it moment. It's a, God, what are you up to? Who am I going to meet? What call will I make? What will I do today that will connect the dots to my destiny? Now, here's my story. Gene and I started a church in Southern California over 30 years ago. It was very tough. We came from a very strict background, almost heresy. We were the only ones going to heaven. Everyone else was going to hell. I mean, everyone else was going to hell. I mean, heaven was going to be for just a few hundred people the way we had calculated it. And we got saved every week because we thought we were going to miss that, being a part of that 100 people going to heaven thing, you know. And so when I started a church at 30, Jeannie and I, we had to break ties with all of that. We started with nothing. We had no one. We had no friends. We had no preacher friends. We stepped into a community. I remember the loneliness I felt. We were able to put a down payment on a house because of an inheritance, but the monthly payment, I worked a job as a key grip for a small production company. She played the piano at the Broadway, which back in those days at South Coast Plaza was the thing, and she played, and they asked her to play secular music. She didn't know secular music, and she would just play worship music, and people would come by her and say, I don't know what you're playing, but I can't stop crying. One lady came by one time and said, I'm late for an appointment, but I just keep circling. I don't know what you're playing, but I can't leave this place. Well, we did whatever we could just to keep some cash and money coming through. We had a clunker car, but we had learned something very important, that our environment determines how we feel. And we learned that God made our bodies to wherever you put your body at, your body will adapt to whatever environment you put it in. If you go in a jacuzzi, if you go into a sauna, if you're in hot temperature, cold temperature, wherever you place your body, your physical body will adapt to it. Well, your soul, your thoughts, your will, your passion is the same way. So we had a little trick we would do on ourselves. We don't have enough money. We're struggling. We're failing. It looks like we're going to fail at this thing, but we would park about 3 blocks from the Ritz-Carlton in Laguna Niguel, and we'd get $37, sometimes quarters and pennies, stop by the bank and get $37 cash. And then we would take our nicest clothes, and we would walk to the Ritz-Carlton and act like we were one of them. And we would go into the restaurant, and we could order an English muffin each, orange juice each, and leave a decent tip, and that's 33 years ago, for $37. And we would just take our time, and then we would get up and we'd just walk around, and there would be $1 million paintings, and celebrities, and stars, and millionaires, and we just soak it up, and after about an hour of that, we started feeling like we weren't poor. We were in the jacuzzi of success. And started feeling like we'd get in the elevators like we were going to a room. And it got to the place where I grew into that mindset. And then I had a real breakfast one time. I could order anything I wanted. And then we did lunch. And then the day came where we could do dinner. And then the day came where I had a nice enough car that I pulled right up in front of the Ritz-Carlton. And then I learned something. I learned that valets, they have access to dinner, tables, reservations, the best rooms. They know everything. So I would give a $20 bill to the valet. They would park my car right over there so I don't have to stand in line. And then they would help me get a table. And every time I went to the Ritz-Carlton, I could see them. They were all hustling, trying to get in front so they could get my $20. Reverend Munsey, how you doing today? Parked my car right over there. Well, there was this young man who, his father passed away, and he was stepping up in a position to pastor his father's church. He didn't know any preacher. He didn't have any connections to preachers. And this thing was really taking off, and he didn't really know what was happening, how to do it. Him and his wife were on vacation, and they said, you know what, we got to learn. He had never been to another church outside of his father's church, outside of a foreign country. And he said, we need to go to another church because we don't really know what to do. We need to learn. So there was a church in L.A., Jim Reeve, Faith Community Church, one of my dear friends. He has a big church, and they were going to go and sneak in and kind of observe so that they too could learn how to pastor. Well, they got out in the car on that Sunday morning, and they handed the valet the information how to get there, and he knew right where it was at. You just get on the 5, get on the 55, the 57, take that to the 210, boom. And the pastor's wife said, well, how long will that take? He said, oh, about an hour, maybe an hour and 5 minutes. She said, oh, man, we're on vacation. I don't want to drive an hour one way. And the valet said, you should go to Reverend Munsey's church. $20. Treat everyone like they're the gatekeeper to your destiny. And one day, you'll be right. Because that young preacher was Joel. And that wife was Victoria. And they walked into my little church. His world changed. My world changed. The next year on their vacation, we were eating with one of my friends, Tommy Tenney, who God had told me to serve. Do anybody remember the Henderson Revival? I got to watch my Henderson Revival TBN did several years ago. Well, I got to be a part of that because I pastored the Crouches. I was preaching two or three times every week on TBN, and the TBN network blew up. It was unbelievable. And there was such an incredible revival, and out of that revival came some fresh voices in the body of Christ. And I had people that worked for TBN, so they would tell me who's getting the most mail. That was before the internet. And they would say, Phil, Pastor Phil, you're getting mail, man. People love your ministry. And there was two other guys that most people didn't really know about. There was a guy named Mark Serona. He was pastoring in Charlotte, and he blew up. Ended up getting his own TV show booked, moved up Florida. Unbelievable. There was another guy who was pastoring in West Virginia. And he was blowing up. People were writing letters to him. His name was T.D. Jakes. He gave up that little church of 300 people, moved to Dallas. The rest is history. A year and a half later, Mark Serona blowing up TV book deals. T.D. Jakes blowing up book deals. Phil Munsey, nothing. I would say to God, I'll be out there. I'm doing my walk of praise, and God, use me. When are you going to use me like you used those others? We were all right there. It's like you picked the tune, left me. And I had my pout session about every day. No, I had good days. One day I was doing that, and I was saying, God, what about me? And nothing, and I just kept walking, and finally I heard the voice of God. The voice of God said, you want to touch the world? I do. You know I do. I've been telling you I want to. He said, I'm going to let you touch the world. I thought, oh God, what will I name my book? The TV show. Should it be the Phil Munsey show? Should it be Today with Phil Munsey? What? Oh God. Okay, I'm sorry, God. Yes, go ahead. What is it? I heard this. Do you care who gets the credit? Of course, that sobered me up very quick. I just, my tears dried up and the snot went back up in my nose. And I just, well, of course, God. Who cares? It's all to the glory of God. God said, I want you to serve Tommy Tenney. Well, I knew Tommy Tenney. I was older than Tommy Tenney. He said, I want you to carry his bag. I want you to, on your own expenses, go and follow Tommy Tenney, and everywhere he goes, you're going to help carry the bag. You're going to serve him so he can do what he's doing, because it's a sacrifice on him and his family. And you're going to serve him. I said, well, God, what about the... Okay. I called Tommy Tenney. He was in Hollywood by, you know, getting a movie deal done. And I went there and I talked to him. Afterwards, I said, I'm so sorry. Is this being taped? Because I need to edit this thing if this is being taped. All right, so I gotta hurry. So I went there. So afterwards, he's got all this big time stuff going. Afterwards, he said, "Hey, Phil, man, it's great to hang out." I said, "Look, I came on a mission. I heard the voice of God today. I've heard him about a dozen times in my life, and this is one of them." And God said to serve you. He said, "Oh, Phil, that's not gonna happen. You're my friend." I said, "I'm as serious as cancer. God told me to do this, so get ready. Tell me your schedule. I'll meet you there. I'll be carrying your bag." And I did that. So then Tommy Tenney calls me, and he says, I want you to come. We're having some food. Our booking company, our publisher's having big suite. They got food. And I said, well, it was a year later, and I had Joel with me.
I said, well, I got Joel Osteen with you. Oh, they said, that's cool, bring him with us. I said, Joel, you want to go there? They're booking people who've got a big suite. And he said, no, I don't want to do that. I said, we're just going to hang around with Victoria and Jeannie, and they're just shopping. This is boring. Let's go. We'll get free food. We went. During that conversation, everybody was so fascinated with Joel. And they're talking, and one guy said, you need to write a book. I said, no, no. He said, who would read it and what would I say? And we got in the car. I said, Joel, you need to write a book. He said, no, I don't feel that. I don't tell me, God's telling me to do that. I said, oh, Joe. He said, who would read it and what would I say? And this went on for a month. Hey, Joe, you sure you shouldn't be doing a book? No, no, man, God hadn't told me to do that. 6 months later, we're talking every week. All of a sudden, he brings it up. Phil, God's put something in my spirit. I think I'm supposed to do a book. Who's that guy's name? And what do we do next? 35 million books and booklets later. Now, treat everybody like they're the gatekeeper to your destiny. Every day, destiny is whispering, give us this day our daily. What is it? What is it? What is it? What phone call am I to make? What phone call am I to return? Who am I shaking hands with? Who am I putting a tip in their hands? Who am I serving? Who am I getting behind? Who am I recognizing that I want to touch the world and it doesn't matter who gets the credit? Because I haven't sold 35 million books, but let me tell you this. I can take you to every chapter, and I can point out, that's me. That line, that's me. I'm in there. And I am touching the world. I go to bed at night knowing that I'm touching so many people. I can't even imagine that I get to do what I get to do. When I tell you, you matter to God. When I tell you that there is no duds in the kingdom. Then I tell you that if you don't care who gets the credit, destiny is whispering to you every day. Doors are opening and closing all around you. Sit down. I got to close. I got to close. I got to close. I got four closings. Here's my first. Oh, yeah. No, I've learned. You just worship. You just worship God, and when doors come, it's a no, it's a go, it's a slow. That if I worship, and I make sure I worship 7 to 8 minutes every morning until I feel the press essence, until I get a witness that it happened. The paper towel came out. The water opened up. I'm good. And when it comes, when life comes at me, wrong relationship. Key goes in the door. Doesn't open. Move along. Move along. A job. Wow. Making more money. Woo! I'm going to take it. Oh, wait just a second. I got to remember I got this key in my hand. Father, I worship you. I thank you for the key of David. Because when I worship, see, when you worship, see, everywhere God's mentioned in Revelation, he's mentioned in three tenses. He that was, is, and is to come. When you give God thanks, you're going down memory lane. You're going back to see where God was. And you're reminding yourself that he's been faithful. When you praise him, you're in the now moment. Because wherever there's praise, he inhabits the praise of his people. Where is God? Wherever there's praise, you're there. But when you worship, you slip into a garment of the of the prophetic. God lives in the, I was there, I'm here, but I'm also there in the future. And when you worship, God allows you to go where he is. And he allows you to get a, your mind can't get it. He got to turn the brain off because the mind, it's like a game. It tilts, you know, you got to unplug and start over. You worship, and when you do, God takes you into the future and he gives you a perspective of what he has seen for you. Come up here and let me show you things that are come. And this is when you're praying and you're saying, God, this man that I've been dating, I think he's the one. He opens up the door for me when we go out to eat. He pays the bill at McDonald's when he takes me out to eat. And he's so kind to me. I believe he's the one, God. But when you worship and you get that key out and you put it in the door and it don't open, and you just jiggle that key, and you push up against that door, and you say, God, I'm getting older now, and I don't have that many dates anymore, and this guy, he's been taking good care of me, and God opened up this door, and God says, this ain't your door. And you worship 5, 7, 8 minutes until you get a peace that transcends all understanding. And when you go, you don't understand why you say, you know what, he's not the right one. You can't explain it. You don't really know. You're not aware. You couldn't possibly know that he's living with his mother sleeping on the couch, and that's her car and her credit card. And that he can't hold a job, and he never could hold a job. And though he knows how to talk the charm, you know, you just got saved because God shut a door. Because that's what worship does. It takes you into the future, gives you a check in your spirit. And it's a no, and it's a go. And when you get a no, you got to move your feet out of the door. Move your fingers back. Move your feelings back. I worked with Pastor Joe and volunteered for 10 years. Because I'd learned how to do it with Tommy. I did it for Pastor Joe. Did the same thing, Pastor Ben. On my own expense, my own time. Did whatever I could. There are times the staff didn't understand me. They thought I was trying to get something out of Joe. I was his friend. Sometimes I'd have to buy a ticket from the gate to get in so that I could go backstage and help Joe. Because nobody understood what I was trying to do. But I knew God told me to do it, and I did it. I got my feelings hurt a lot of times. A lot of times I thought, I could have my own. Why am I doing this? This could be hurting my own personal ambitions. God said, no, this is the door. I put that key in. God said, go walk through this door. This is your door. And then God started giving me hints that I needed to give up a transition out of our church. And I just thought, no, I can't do this. And I know my time. Can I just... I said, God, I can do this. I can work for Joel. And now we got all these churches coming, and I can work with all these pastors, and I can still do my church. And God was trying to whisper to me, we're done here. Well, I wasn't going to hear that. Because, you know, I've been taught all my life from the powerful Word of God, winners never quit, and quitters never win. And every time I got discouraged, I could see that the fruit wasn't there, the favor wasn't there. The fervency wasn't there. I would just preach my way back into a I'm never going to give up sermon. And that would keep me going for a little bit. But the fruit wasn't there. The fervor wasn't there. The favor wasn't there. But I can't give up. And one day I thought, I got to preach another message about not giving up, not quitting. I got to find that scripture. Never winners never quit, and quitters never win. And I looked up in the concordance. I couldn't find it. I Googled it. Vince Lombardi said it. I thought, I'm hanging my whole life on the words of Vince Lombardi. Because God was trying to tell me, yeah, quitters quit the right thing at the right time in the right way. Winners know when to say, that door's closed, we're done here. And Jesus came to me in my prayer one time, weeping to God, saying, God, why is my church failing? I'm embarrassed. The fruit... I don't even want my friends to come. I don't. What's going on? Leave. Oh, I'm not going to leave. No, my daddy taught me you never give up. We're done here. And that's when Jesus told me, I am the beginning, but I'm also an end. And sometimes I just say to you, the end. I have 3 beautiful grandchildren. I love to tell stories to them. I can hear my children downstairs now, the children downstairs now. They're hoping I hurry up and get done. Those workers are hurrying. They're hoping. But we used to tell stories with before Colin came, Peyton and Declan. We used to tell stories to each other. And Peyton, she's got imagination like me. We just make up stories. There was this old man. He was climbing up a hill, and the rain came, and the snow, and an eagle came, and then an elephant. Boy, we're just going at it. And in California, we have fireplaces. I don't know why we don't need them. Apartments with one bedroom have fireplaces. And we turn the air conditioning down real low and then put the fireplace on so we could act like we could use it. And we'd tell stories. And Declan, he's more pragmatic, very introvert, very thinking, very... And so we would just go carrying on. And he would say, Papa, now, is it my turn? No, not yet. Because we knew what he wanted to do. And we just kept going. And now Peyton and I, we're just wore out. We've had elephants. We've had snow. We've fallen. We've had an eagle come and pick us up. We are done. And we're just going towards the end. And Declan, meanwhile, every 5 minutes, can I, now, Papa? No. And then finally, okay, Declan, your turn. The end. And that's what Jesus was saying to me. We're done here. I got bigger things for you. The end. It was so painful. I'm sorry I'm going here. This is personal, but it was so painful to go through this. I felt like a failure. I struggled to keep that door open. I finally brought my fingers, my feet, my feelings. I know what I'm talking about. I remember going through the times where we couldn't get the finances. Different things weren't happening. And I just remember it was so painful. And then when I finally surrendered and I put the key in the door, and Jesus said, I love you. You're one of my favorites. I got good things for you. Trust me. This is a no-go right now. And I put the key in the door. The door opened. And when I opened up, I went from a caterpillar to a butterfly. I stepped into a destiny that has been waiting for me before time began. I went out to eat a few months ago with one of our successful businessmen in the church. And while we were eating, he was saying, Phil, you look so good. You look so young. You're looking so great. And he said, I just got to tell you, man, it was tough watching you go through that at the church. And he said, you know what? He's a very wealthy guy. In fact, he's one of the wealthiest persons I ever knew. And he'd take me out to eat about every 2 weeks. And every time we were going out to eat during that struggle, I kept, yeah. And get waiting for that final, well, I'll see you. And Pastor, here, the Lord laid it on my heart. And none of that happened ever. My wife one time said to her, why you keep going out to eat with him? I believe he's a miracle. Well, it's been 2 years and ain't no miracle. And he said, you're just so happy. He said, Pastor, I got to tell you something. He said, one Sunday morning we got up and God told us to write a check out for $277,000. It was the money we needed to get rid of a debt that had been carried on that was choking us. And when he said that, something went off into my spirit, and we were at P.F. Chang's in Irvine, California. And he said, you know what? We didn't bring it. And the next week, we didn't bring it. And the next week, and we never got a release to bring that check. And at P.F. Chang's on that noon, I stood up. He was a little embarrassed, cut packets. What are you doing? I said, I'm giving you a standing ovation. Thank you for not bringing that check. Because had you brought that check, I would still be there. And where I am right now, heaven's been waiting for eternity for me to get here. Friends, the key of David will open doors you can't open and shut doors you can't shut. Are you hearing me? Would you just lift your hands just comfortably, just any way that just says you're ready to receive the prophetic word? Father, I thank you. You all come to the... Yeah, when they do that, that's for real now. That means it's coming down to... So thank you, Jesus. Said, I receive the key of David. Today, by the power given to me as a servant of the Most High God with an apostolic mission, I set in motion a shifting in this church. A shifting in your life. Today, I set in motion that you will no longer guess. You will no longer cross your fingers. You will no longer stumble into doors you have no business walking in through. And you'll never get your feelings hurt for those that close. For you will leave here knowing that God loves you and that there's nothing He wouldn't do for you. And that a no can sometimes be the best thing you could ever hear. When God has got something better for you waiting. Father, let what I said today pierce through any barriers they may have with me or with my lack of ability to communicate what you're really saying to them. I love you. I'm for you. I'm here for you. I'm giving you a key. Learn how to use it 7 to 8 minutes a day. And you will never walk into a door that doesn't belong to you. And there'll be no door rejected to you that I don't have something better. Or that if even man tries to shut the door, you will get through. Because I'm giving you my key of David. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now for 90 seconds, I would like you to practice the presence of the Lord. And some of you, this comes easy, although it might be in the soulless realm. So test yourself to make sure. you're not being led by your five senses nor just your emotions, but that you can hear the Spirit and you can feel the Spirit. You can feel this something eternal inside you, and you can feel it connecting to that which is eternal in heaven. And let the press essence of God bear witness that today you have received the key of David. I worship you. Don't need to do it for 2 to 3 hours. Sometimes I won't have time to fast 2 or 3 days for a decision. Sometimes all I'll need to do is just get into that press essence of God. And when I feel a witness of His presence, and then I put my key in that door, and if it opens, no man will get credit for that. For that's the door God opened through the key of David. And if that door closes, though my feelings are hurt, I know the day will come when I'll thank God for that door closing. I'll one day say, thank you for not doing what you thought you were supposed to do, because you would have prolonged my season in the wrong place. Hey. Some of you are beginning to feel the presence of the Lord. Lift your hands just a little bit higher as a sign that you're getting witness from the Holy Spirit. Open up your mouth just a little bit and say, hallelujah, I worship you. Move your hands, as it were, in front of that faucet. Move your hands, as it were, in front of that paper towel machine. And say, I worship you, Lord, I worship. Prophetic place, that place you have prepared for me. And though I may not know how to get there with my eyes, the Holy Spirit will lead me there, because I have the key of David. Oh Jesus, my time. I've got to do one more thing. Can everybody stand for these last few moments here? Just stand with me one time. I've got to do this, and then I've got something special to share with you. But would you just place your hands over your heart? I've got to obey God when He tells me to do this, because you'll thank me for this 1,000 years from now. You'll thank me for this. There are times in our life where habits and destructive behaviors and things get in our head through bad parenting or bad experiences with the ex, or people do things to us, or we go to dark places when we feel discouraged and we pick up bad, destructive habits, and then we can't break out of them. And some of you know what I'm talking about, and I'm speaking now about a particular one that I'm not even going to say, because if I say what the problem is, the devil will have one more shot at you, shaming you. And I'm not going to let him have not even one more second of shame over your life. But you know what it is. You try to stop. You've had even counseling. You've done everything you can to stop it. You can't. It goes a while, and then there it comes right back up again. And you're like, oh my God, I'm so ashamed of myself. I can't stop this behavior. And when God tells me to do this, I do it. And our time is so, but I'm going to obey God, and you'll thank me for this 1,000 years from now, because the Lord has given me the authority to do something that will change your life forever right now. I'm going to speak to those of you that have destructive habits, and there are activities that you fall into constantly. And no matter how, 3 days, 3 months, 3 months, 3 years, it owns you, it's yours. And you have barricaded that door, and you have done everything you can to shut that door, and you can't shut it. At will, that door opens and intimidates you and pulls you into that dark place. But I have the authority prophetically right now to tell you that God, watch me, every eye on me, God is going to shut that door in the next 90 seconds. Listen to me. Let me tell you how well he's going to shut this door. This will blow your mind. And I won't say it unless I get a witness of the Spirit because it's pretty bold. Are you ready? God is going to shut that door. You know exactly what I'm talking about. It shames you. It is what you are addicted to during your dark times. And you've tried to get rid of it. And God says, today, I will, through the key of David, shut that door. And no man, including you, will be able to open up that door. You didn't hear me. You will get down, you'll get discouraged, and you'll reach your hand out to that door and you say, I'm going there. And you're going to put your hand on that door. And it ain't going to open. It's not going to open. In your weak moment, you're going to say, here I go again. And when you put your hands on that doorknob, you know why? Because God's going to shut that door through the key of David that no man can open, not even you. Somebody ought to lift their hands right now, because that may be you, and say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Now, Father, I pray that the same scripture that we hear out of Revelation chapter 3, that in these last few moments before I release something special, that you said that you stand at the door of men's hearts, and if we'll open up our heart, you will come in. Father, bring redemption, bring renewal, bring salvation, and we'll confirm it before this moment and this service is over. Thank you for what you're doing today. And everybody say amen. How many hear the word of the Lord today? You hear it? You hear it? Somebody give God praise right now. Come on. The best way you know how. Somebody give God a little bit of worship. Amen. You may be seated. I want to thank you so much. I do. I feel like apologizing because I know that our time is beyond what you normally do. And I honestly respect you all. And I hope that I obeyed God, because it would be rude for me to have taken this time. We're coming now to that portion of the service that becomes the portion of the service that sets everything in motion for us. And I've asked Pastor Ben if I could serve you today, because I have a word about how to help you today. And so I'd like to take just a couple moments to share it with you. It's about how God wants to open up another door for you. That is to open up the door of the windows of heaven for you financially. And I'm going to give you a revelation in the next 3 minutes that you've never heard before, and it will change your life. I told you I pastored Oral Roberts. If you don't know who Oral Roberts is, he's Oral Roberts University. He raised $1 billion for the kingdom. He prayed for over 1.5 million people in his lifetime personally with his laying on of hands. Powerful man. And he used to sit right where Pastor Doug is sitting, right about right there every Sunday morning. It's pretty intimidating to preach to one of the great saints, one of the great apostles of the history of the church. One time he said to me, he said, Phil, he said, never take an offering. And he said that. I was like, what? That's the way a church survives. You take an offering. He said, no, 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 no. He said, never use the word take. Because you put it in the people's mind that God is taking something from them. And he said, the people must never see God as a taker, because God is not a taker. That was hard for you to say amen to, wasn't it? Then he said this to me. God is no more a taker than the earth is a taker of the seed. For the earth does not take the seed. The earth allows that seed that you release in its power to give back to you. The scripture came to mind, and I could never understand it in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. The Bible says that God provides seed for the sower. How many have ever heard that before? Don't go anywhere right now. I want you to hear this because I don't want you to get in your automatic pilot mode right now. I want you to hear this. God said, I provide seed for the sower. And I said to God one time, all right, so Oral tells me, tithe and offering is not a debt I owe, but a seed I sow. God is not a taker, Phil. He's a giver. And this is all part of like the earth takes a seed. God says, put it in my hands. It won't be the last time you see it. So I'm saying to God now, 2 Corinthians 9, right? Are you with me? You're going to like this. I'm eating an apple. I'm eating an apple, and I'm asking God, how do you give seed to the sower? And here's what God says to me. You like that apple? I said, yeah. I take another bite. Crunch. You like that apple? Yeah. God said to me, enjoy it. I'm like, cool, because I was raised with God didn't like you to enjoy things. I mean, know what I'm talking about. It's like, if it was fun, it was a sin. And if you were having a good time, you were probably against God's will. And for God to say to me, you like that apple? Yeah. He said, Phil, I want you to see that apple as your car, as your clothes, as your family, as your vacation, as your money, as your fun. I want you to take that apple, and it brings me great joy to let you enjoy that apple. And now I'm really having a good time. Crunch. And as I'm eating that apple, as it gets closer to the core, I'm seeing something black in there, and the tone of God changes. And it goes from, have a good time. Have fun, shop, eat, good time. The apple's yours, it's the fruit of your labor. I want you to enjoy it. But when my eyes made contact with that black seed, I felt the tone of God say, now, he said, when it comes to that seed, that's mine. Because you can't do anything with that. It ain't gonna bring any nutriment. Nutriment is a word, I just made that up. You know what it means, right? Nutritious and nutrient. I made it up. I'm me and George Bush. We're amazing. He said, now that seed belongs to me. Catch this now. That seed belongs into a system that I've created to make sure that there'll never be a lack of apples on the earth. So when you eat that apple, I want you to enjoy it. I want you to enjoy it. I don't want you to have any guilt, no shame. I want you to enjoy it. So much fun. But when it comes to that seed now, he said, now you can't do anything with that seed. I gave in every, here's what God said to me. And every blessing I give you, there's a seed in there. And if you eat it, you ended the cycle of favor that God had nothing to do with law. Has nothing to do, it has to do with how God perpetuates his wealth. When God gives you a dollar, not all of that is for consumption. There's a seed in there. I call it the tithe. It was way before the law. Melchizedek was 400 years before the law. And Jesus made the connection with that, saying that whenever you want to perpetuate greatness, you got to find the portion of what you have that he blesses you with and know there's a seed in there you're not supposed to eat. And don't give it to Walmart. They can't do anything with it. It just goes in the cash register. Then it shows up on the accounting book. And then it gets lost because they have no power to pull out of that seed what's in there. Don't let your mortgage... Don't let that seed go... In fact, I've learned since that somebody told me if you eat apple seeds, they'll actually be poisonous to you. Can I tell you? Don't eat the seed. It ain't going to help you. And every dollar that you get... I even tell people, when I help somebody, when someone says, hey, I need $20 to put gas in my car, I say, here's the $20 now. There's seed in here. Don't put the whole $20 in the car. Because if you do, you just buried the seed in that gas tank. It can't do nothing any good. You make sure you take a couple dollars of this $20, you break it up, and you say, this is the seed that God put in there. So that I would never be without lack of seeing a harvest because God provides seed. And so the mindset that I want you to have today is every time God blesses you, and even if somebody, a friend gives it to you, even if it's not like through a paycheck, every blessing you have, today I'm asking you to say, there's a seed in there. And I'm not going to eat that seed. That seed goes back into the kingdom where he will take that seed and he will say, and when a farmer doesn't do this, right? Here's a farmer. Buy seed. I had so much fun watching you on my shelf.
And now I have to say goodbye. Bye, seed.
No, the farmer's like, where? Where? Because when I drop that seed in the ground, I know it's not the last time I'll see it. I'll see it again, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So today, I want you to take the shame, the guilt, the religious duty, because that runs out of gas every so often. And around Christmas time, when it's time to buy gifts and you got to do extra things, religion will wear you down, and that's when you'll say, I don't know if I can do this. But when you recognize that there's a seed in there, that tithe is a seed, that's not something that's being taken from you. God is not a taker. How many receive what I'm saying to you? All right, now you can. So, Father, now go ahead. However you prepare your giving, I'm going to turn it over to the pastor. But I wanted to lift his hands today because this is something that is difficult to get up every week and to face you, knowing that you've got all of these thoughts in your mind. And today I wanted to come in with a fresh word to tell you, God is not a taker. This is not a sad time of the service. This is the service that tells us, the part of the service that guarantees that we'll never lack for relationships. We'll never lack for resources. We'll never lack because God provides seed for the sower. And everything He gives us, there's a seed in there. Never forget it. I love you all very much. Thank you for your doing what you know to do. I'm going to turn it over back to you. Thank you for the great honor. I hope you'll let me come back again, please. I had the time of my life. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Amen. Come on, let's shout. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, ushers, go ahead and pass out. Have you passed out those offering envelopes? Let's pass those out very, very quickly. That was a powerful word. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the word of God. We thank you for the impartation of Holy Spirit that happened here on this morning. We thank you, Lord, for unlimited return on every word. God, I thank you that we have the key of David. Glory to God. And we engage your presence and we commune with you. And we thank you, Father. Oh, what a powerful word. I'm so excited. Glory to God. We get to give. Hallelujah. Isn't that a blessing? We thank you, Lord, for our tithe and offering on today. We thank you, Lord, for supernatural increase. What a powerful word of connection and obedience and submitting yourself to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, we bless you and we thank you. And we thank you, Lord, even for all that you have in this 2016. Father, we thank you that you have closed doors this year, that you've opened doors, and there are still more doors for us to access this year, said the Spirit of God. Get your expectation up real high. Get your expectation up real high. Come on, we serve a God of great impossibilities. Miraculous turnaround, supernatural breakthroughs. Thank you for new realms and new dimensions. Thank you, Lord, for strategies, insight, connections. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. I am stirred up. Thank you, Lord. Thank God for the presence and the power of God that's in this place. Once you prepared your tithe and offering, write on that offering envelope exactly what you're believing God for. Some of you are believing God for some things to happen this month, and we set our faith in agreement. And just like it's happening for your spiritual father, Dr. Ben Tanker, you have that same anointing that is upon your life for doors to open supernaturally in Jesus' name. Things that you did not expect to happen right now. How many of you believe that? Throw your hand up and say, I receive that right now. Once you've prepared your tithe and offering, go ahead and stand to your feet. Don't forget to write on there what you're believing God for. We place a demand on that anointing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You know, the Bible says that when we give our tithe and offering, that it rebukes the devourer. And I'm so excited this morning. I see our spiritual son back there, Anthony Wallace. He was in a forest fire, a real live forest fire. The fire was all around you, wasn't it? But it couldn't access you, couldn't. That's called the power of God showing up in your life. You know, that's one thing about it. You can know as a believer when, listen, we're not just going through the motion. The enemy doesn't have access to you. When you spend time in the presence of God, the enemy cannot access you. The Bible says the weapon could be formed, but it won't prosper. Glory to God. So we just thank God for your life. Hallelujah. And you saw the power of God for yourself. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Once you prepare that tithe and offering, go and stand to your feet. All tithers, come on into the middle aisle. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Lord, we thank you this morning. We praise you this morning. We honor you this morning. Glory to God. All right, let's get ready to say our confession. If you guys could please stand on your feet. We want to all operate in one accord in the house this morning. In honor to the Spirit of God, if you're still sitting, if you could just stand with us. The Bible says a corporate anointing causes corporate results. Hallelujah. Unless you handicap, can you get on your feet, please, this morning? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And thank the Lord for activity in your limbs. Like the old folks say, I can move my feet. Come on, somebody. Amen. All right. Let's make our confession together as we sow our weekly tithe and offering first fruits and gifts of love. We believe the blessing of the Lord makes us rich and adds no sorrow to it. We expect a fresh wave of wealth and favor to come to us now. God has made me rich and famous in my fields of specialty. I will use my huge influence with humility to advance the kingdom of God and bless the body of Christ. Destiny Center will renovate, pay off, and upgrade our current facility, as well as acquire the buildings next door and across the street, debt-free for our youth and administrative offices. We will not forsake or neglect the house of our God. As we serve our local community, we will faithfully maintain our present blessings and responsibilities with an attitude of gratitude. As we stretch for the future, we declare our church and every giver's home, and debts are totally paid off in Jesus' name. Yes, indeed, it won't be long now. God's decree, things are going to happen so fast, our head will swim. One thing fast on the heels of the other. I won't be able to keep up. Everything will be happening.